So these are the objectives for today, two lectures. It's quite heavy stuff because it's learning about some diseases. But I asked you to participate once in a while, and I'm going to ask you questions about how these diseases are related to your work as engineers in the field. So we're going to cover first some of the linkages between human health and environmental health to give us a kind of a background on it. And then we're going into some of the specific diseases in the second half. So if you look up environmental health in the WHO, they have actually whole reports about different definitions of environmental health. There's no consensus how to define environmental health. It can be defined narrowly or very broadly to encompass almost everything in our world if we define everything as the environment. But these are some of the factors, the physical, chemical, biological, social, and psychosocial factors in the environment that are usually included in definitions of environmental health. But if you read the second paragraph, it also refers to the theory and practice of assessing, correcting, controlling, and preventing factors. So it's a lot about how humans behave and act in the environment as well. So it's not something that is devoid of human touch, environmental health. It's a lot about how humans act and interact with their environment, and how they may create hazards and how they control and prevent hazards. Okay? So it has a physical, chemical side, and it has a human behavioral side. Yeah? I was actually shocked when I started to read these reports again to see how high these numbers are. So 24% of the disease burden in the world is caused by environmental factors. It's a quarter of all disease in the world that is caused by environmental factors. That's a very, very, very big number. And lots of that disease burden can be prevented. 23% of all deaths are caused by modifiable environmental factors. 23% of all deaths, that's an enormous number that we here in this group as environmental engineers can actually help to prevent by controlling factors in the environment. Modifiable environmental factors, so it means everything that we can actually change. So when WHO is creating these estimates, they're only estimating what we can actually change and control. So they're not measuring, for example, if there's a natural, if there's a landscape and there are some natural hazard in the landscape that we cannot change, for example, tall trees, we're not going to cut down the trees or change a river or something. They're not estimating that. So they're estimating the factors, the risks from factors that can be modified with simpler or more advanced changes of the environment. If you should guess, where are the biggest risks from the environmental risks or hazards, and who are most at risk? Try to talk to the one next to you for 2 minutes and guess where in the world and who in the world are most at risk. Where or who are at risk?
Children under 5.
Yes, it's always a big risk group. Why would you think?
Well, if they don't get enough food, they are more polluted.
Yeah, affected by.
Diseases from the water, species.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes.
The immune
system is off the rails. Exactly. So they catch all kinds of diseases and are more affected by disease than adults. Yeah. Yes.
I think that, like diarrhea, is one of the worst. A simple thing that can be prevented by hygiene and can kill children.
Yeah. Exactly. So diarrheal disease is one of the big disease groups under environmental, which can be prevented by environmental control measures, and it always affects children under 5, much more than adults. Yeah, they're more sick and they die more often. Yeah? Where in the world would you think that environmental diseases or risk factors are concentrated? Yeah.
In the cities, in the
slums,
because they live much closer to people.
Yeah, so cities and slums, so poor and urban combined. Yeah. Any other? Other risk groups?
Old people.
Old people, yeah.
Pregnant women.
Pregnant women. Always, they're always more susceptible to different diseases and if you think about all kinds of aspects of environmental health, then occupational health is a big group, right? We are, a lot of diseases stem from the occupation we have if we engage in different environments. So who would then be risk groups, do you think? Can you think of risk groups?
Yeah?
Workers in sanitation. They are very, very exposed, yeah. If you think broader than sanitation.
People working in the fields?
Yeah, so farmers, people working in agriculture, right. They're actually a big risk group. Okay, so let's have a look at the world, or at the environmental factors that WHO, they integrate into their measures. Pollution of air, water, soil, with chemicals or biological agents. So some of you have already mentioned sanitation issues, but there are also air pollution, right? And it's rising rapidly in some parts of the world. Water pollution, some of you also mentioned that. UV, noise, occupational risks, related to the built environment, so infrastructures, housing, lands, roads, right? Road accidents, traffic, injuries on roads. It's a big group of the environmental diseases, especially rising in low and middle income countries as the traffic is growing. Right? Agricultural methods, irrigation schemes, lots of disease attached to that. We'll come back to that. Climate change and ecosystem change. That's also one of your main fields, I guess. Is that right? Climate issues, ecosystem issues. Lots of disease attached to this field as we change our ecosystem in different ways with the businesses or agricultural practices that are changed. Risks can arise. And behavior related to sanitation and water, which you mentioned, like washing hands, contaminated foods, like you mentioned, unsafe water and unclean hands. So here's the world, and the darker the areas, the more disease is concentrated. So sub-Saharan Africa, and the rest of Africa, and Asia are the high risk areas, but with, like you said, with risk spots in urban poor settings, yeah, where people are crowded, have poor water and sanitation, and so on. Anything surprising here? Yeah.
We just did a high risk spot in Alaska. That's all I.
Yeah. Yeah.
It seems a bit strange.
Yeah.
It's all part of Russia. Yeah.
Probably because of poverty related, yeah, because there's poor water supply and poor infrastructure. Yeah.
But apart from that, it's great to South America. I thought that would be more like Africa, maybe.
Yeah.
It doesn't look that bad.
No. Large parts of South America is middle income now, and there's been big investments in basic infrastructure, like roads. Road safety has increased. Water safety is much better now than a decade ago. Yeah.
Any good explanation as to why there's a difference between Western and Eastern Africa? Like, it looks like there's a line going down.
Yeah, I don't know that. But Western Africa is much more dry. Much more dry. So the water supply is poorer. And that gives a lot of diseases. North Africa, I know that the food safety issues, agricultural issues, are big. There are lots of occupational risks and lots of disease attached to food, poor food safety. Yeah? Any other things? So these are the hotspots for poor environmental health. If we look at water, sanitation and hygiene, which is a big field for you, isolated, and we don't look at all the chemical stuff and occupational health and traffic and all that, this is how disease is divided, you could say. Diarrheal diseases, 39% of all diseases related to water, sanitation, hygiene are diarrheal diseases. Not so surprising, like drowning, 6%. In Asia, the drowning is a major problem for small children because there's so much irrigation schemes and dams and so man-made water bodies. And that creates extra risk for children running around, or if there's, in India, they still have a lot of wells that are not covered, so some children fall into wells. Surprisingly, isn't it? But it's actually a major environmental problem. Malnutrition, and this is only protein energy malnutrition, but this is all malnutrition. Very, very big, and we'll see later, it's very connected to the issue of diarrheal diseases, these two. And together they are really the major issue for water, sanitation and hygiene-related diseases. 9% of all deaths could be prevented if we could prevent these things. All this is practically preventable. So 23% of all deaths, all environmental diseases, but WASH alone, 9% of all deaths in the world. So it's staggering numbers, right? It's really many people each year that die from preventable issues that we could solve with a few tools from your program. Diarrhea, this is how it's distributed in the world. So this world map looks strange because the countries have a size that corresponds to the number of diseases that are in the country. So you see India has grown out of proportions, and so has Sub-Saharan Africa and Western Africa. So this is still where the children die. And sadly, this has not changed so much. But a lot of children get diarrhea each year, and 1.5 million people die each year from diarrhea still, and that has been still standing for some time. Approximately 1 million a year children die from diarrhea. It's actually a little bit curious because we have managed to improve treatment enormously. So today we can give ORS, do you know what that is? So oral rehydration salt solutions, so it's liquids with salts and minerals in that can stop the diarrhea or stop the dehydration and then eventually stop the diarrhea. We can give zinc supplementation to children, which increases the absorption of nutrients and liquids in the intestines. All doctors and nurses or any health personnel know in the world that you have to act urgently if a small child has diarrhea, because a small child can die within days of diarrhea. But despite all this, children still die and still get lots and lots and lots of diarrhea. So in addition to treatment and being a good health staff, we need environmental engineers to change, to control issues in the environment and to do what we can to prevent these cases from arising. So these are the areas of intervention, if we think about environmental health. These are the things that you probably will be doing something in your future. And these are the things that evidence shows that this can prevent diseases. Is there anything surprising? But if we look at where these intervention areas belong, you see that they're really spread across many different administrative sectors and different planning offices and so on. I would like you to spend now 5 minutes with one person next to think about, in your country, where who is responsible for environmental health, for planning and implementing interventions. Who is responsible? Someone who's not from Denmark, yeah?
I would say that the government play a very big role, because I'm from Georgia originally, and many things is not done correctly, or people don't care because the government don't have a system for it. They need help to do stuff like something like there is no governmental system, so they just throw it out wherever they want.
Okay, so solid waste management is
and
not taken care of by governmental bodies,
and that gives diseases. And there are so many things that need to have a system before it's done, because a private person can do it.
Yeah. Okay. Are there any other bodies or any other organizations that take care of some of these things, where the governmental systems are not in place? Are there NGOs or are there private waste companies?
I think there is.
Yeah.
There are private waste companies,
yeah.
But it's not systematic.
It's not systematic.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And that's a problem.
Yeah. Any other? In another country, in Denmark, for example, how does it look? Yeah.
Let's improve as a safe management of human data as a digital. Sorry, I'm speaking Danish.
That's okay.
It's like on one hand, it's the commune that has the responsibility for like sewers, but isn't it also like just the household? I mean, no one forces you to have a toilet.
Actually, in Denmark, yes, we force people to have a toilet. It's mandatory if you have a household that you have a waste management system. So some kind of toilet you have to have, and you have to have some kind of waste management system. And if you don't have a sewer that connects to the national sewage system, you have to prove that it's a safe system. For example, a septic tank on your own ground. Some people have that still in Denmark. So some degree it's the commune, some degree it's the private households. Yeah. And some parts of the sewage system, for example, the big, sewage plants, they are national. They are not communal, because that would cost so much money for this, a single commune to have to run a big sewage plant. Right. Yeah. What about nutritional issues or occupational health? Where does that belong in Denmark? No, so that would happen in other fora, in other groups, so it wouldn't be health personnel actually doing the health education sometimes. It would be maybe the teachers or, And another,
I also think that each person is responsible for their own health. For example, you see in films, people are not being countries, like people that are throwing their waste outside, for example, in front of they always, how do you say that,
Ja, prøv at sige det på dansk, ja.
I selv er ansvarlig for, for eksempel, hvad I indtager en kost, og for eksempel, så, så man er selv ansvarlig for,
ja.
For hvad man spiser,
ja.
Så man skal hele tiden tilholde sig sund og rart.
Ja. But for waste management systems, actually, that you talked about and you said something, actually, in many, many low and middle income countries, there are no national waste collection systems. So a lot of that depends much more or relies much more on households to clean their own areas. So in Vietnam, for example, where I did my PhD, there are programs where they are, where people are taught in the communities to keep their own areas clean. So that's a responsibility for the households. You can be fined if you don't clear the gutters or cut the grass or collect your waste or burn plastic. But here in Denmark, it's a different situation. Sometimes I think it's more dirty here in the streets in Denmark than in Vietnam. Because in Denmark, we all rely on the governmental system to clean up the streets, right? The other areas, the point here is that if you look at any country, environmental health intervention areas will be spread across many sectors. And it demands that sectors are cooperating, right? And sometimes interventions fail because they fall in between chairs. Because one sector thinks that it's the other sector. Health, Ministry of Health thinks that they are not responsible for educating children. That must be the Ministry of Education. And Ministry of Education, they say, we can't handle health issues because that has to be medical people that do that. Then who does it, right? So a lot of these intervention areas, when you are going out in the future as environmental engineers, you might have to get hold of the local school teacher or headmaster and the head nurse and the nutritional doctor and the occupational, the road injury guy and stuff, and make them cooperate, right? So that's the whole point. You had a point down there?
Yes, can I take it again?
Sure.
Jeg får ikke meget bevidst om, hvordan vi skal tage på miljø. Altså, for eksempel i Malmøsten, altså i den land, hvor jeg kommer fra, folk har, ikke alle folk er bevidst om, hvor vigtigt det er, at man skal passe på miljø og verden, at det vil påvække ens helbred, og
ja.
Det vil påvække vand, og til gengæld får man sygdom.
Ja. But I think you're right, sometimes we have forgotten where the risks are, because we have big systems to take care of them. We have central sewage systems, central drainage systems, central solid waste management systems. All that is taken care of by some invisible system, right, that we don't have much knowledge about. So we kind of forget sometimes that if we don't flush the toilet, it can bring disease and so on. And in countries or in settings where you don't have the central systems, maybe these hazards are more, they're closer to you. You're more aware of the hazards. Yeah. Nice observation. Okay, we'll move to some health stuff now. And I'll present you with some different diseases and different ways of classifying or categorizing diseases. And I have to admit, it's not all environmental health, it's mainly focused on water, sanitation, and hygiene issues. So that's kind of the mindset we are going into now. So there's almost nothing about chemicals, for example, almost nothing about occupational risks and pollution. And but if you look at the classical water-related diseases, then they can be classified in these four groups here. Have you seen them before? Yes. Did you have lectures about this before? No. It's in your book. Yeah. So you read a chapter about these diseases. So can someone explain to me what is a water-based disease? A water-based disease? Yeah?
So the disease that comes from the water.
And when humans are exposed to water, they are at risk of getting the disease. A water-related disease. It's not much difference here, but there is a difference. Yeah.
If there's still water, mosquitoes breed in still water. So,
yeah.
their offspring carries malaria with them.
Yeah.
So if you're near still water, you're prone to water-related disease.
Yeah. So in this classification, it's mainly about this vector, the agent that transmits the disease, right? Lives is dependent on the water as a breeding site.
Yeah.
So malaria and filariasis is mentioned here. Water washed disease. What is that?
When people have no water to wash themselves, and then, for example, they cannot wash their hands or their body.
Yeah. It's a little more narrow, actually, the definition here. Can somebody expand this definition? Look at the two diseases. Have you read about these two diseases? We go into trachoma as one of the diseases. But you're correct, but it's also these diseases that I mentioned here are controlled and prevented by actually washing. So mechanically, you wash away bacteria or the infection, and you actually prevent the disease from emerging again or manifesting itself if you wash. So having bacteria on your hand is not a disease, but you can wash it off. But these are actually diseases that can disappear if you wash yourself. Yeah? We'll get back to it. It's a little bit complex, and it's not so straightforward, and it's a little muddled, I have to say. But you could also categorize some of the sanitation-related diseases with some categories here. So fecal oral, I heard some of you use those words already. You have read about that. Have you heard about it before? No. Fecal oral, soil transmitted from helmets, water-based helmets, and excreta-related insect sectors. I have to say they are not so straightforward, and some of them are overlapping with the water-related categories. So don't be too frustrated about this. But fecal oral are those. These are just examples. You could put more diseases out here. They are the diseases that are transmitted to humans because the bacteria move from fecal matter through the mouth. We ingest the bacteria and we get sick. So cholera and diarrheal diseases, right? Other diarrheal diseases. Soil transmitted helmets. Have you heard about that? Helmets are different kinds of worms. And they are, or their eggs live in soils and are transmitted to new persons from being exposed to the soil where these worm eggs or worms are in. We will take one as an example later. We'll take hookworm. Water-based helmets are also small worms, but they live in water. And the reason why it's sanitation-related, we'll get back to that. It's a little bit complex, yeah?
This water
game
is called schistosomiasis. Is it the same as
bilharziosis? Yeah, and the same as snail fever. It has many different names. Yeah. We'll get back to that because that's a very complicated disease. and then excreta-related insect vectors, because for example, filariasis is also it's a small mite and it breeds in latrines, so that's why it's sanitation-related. Okay, so we'll take some diseases. The main point here is not that you become medical doctors that can explain all stages of the transmission cycle and so on. The point here is that you as environmental engineers can see this circle and understand how can we break the circle? What interventions could we do in order to prevent and control this disease? So that's the main focus here. You can go home and read on WHO's homepage about all the medical things about it, and I'm not going to explain that. But the point is for us here to identify where and how can we prevent some of these diseases. And do you have a pointer, any of you?
I don't know.
I'll use my finger. I'm going
to we have that.
What is the ruler?
Tilde, maybe you can use the ruler.
Okay. think about the circle like this. It's actually two circles, right? And we start up here where the human is infected. It's infected by a small larvae that that is in the water. And when the human is in the water and has contact with the water, this small thing penetrates the skin, and or you ingest it from the mouth. When you swim, you accidentally get a little bit into your mouth. And it migrates to your intestines, where it sucks blood. And at some point when it's mature, it goes to the liver, where it sits for some time, and also creates small infiltrations in the tissue. And then they develop into worms, and curiously enough, I don't know why, they live in pairs. These worms, they lay eggs. And they lay eggs in the human tissue, in the liver or in the gallbladder and in different other organs. And you see here, some of them can do migrate to migrate to the intestines where they can be excreted as feces, or they can go to the gallbladder, the bladder, and they can be excreted as urine. So it's a quite complex circle, I'm not going to go into it, but you ingest it when you swim, it develops in the body, and it's excreted in two ways, in urine or in feces. So here, in urine or in feces. Right. How does it get back to the water? It does that when people are urinating or defecating in water. These eggs, they need to go into the water in order to develop again. So it's only when people leave their urine or their feces in water again that these eggs can hatch. They find a snail in the water that they infect, and then inside the snail they are able to develop again into these small larvae, sporocytes, that again are in the water and the human can again ingest it. The bad thing about this disease is not so much the worms in itself, but it's all the eggs that the worms lay in the human tissue. They're kind of creating some small nodules or some small knuder in the vein. And that can disturb our organs. So if you look at a patient that has a lot of these infections, you have these parts of the tissue that are damaged. You can get like a central nervous system disrupting from that, and also your liver stops working and so on. If it's small children that are infected, they can also get anemia and pain and stomach pains and so on, because they lose blood when these worms are sucking blood inside them. So now you are the engineers, clever engineers that has to stop schistosomiasis. Where are the points in this strange circle where we could intervene and do something? Yeah?
Defecating near water.
Yeah. So we have to stop that they get into water again, right? Yeah. Yeah. Stop defecating in the water and stop urinating in the water. And if the guys in here think about it and you've been traveling, isn't it nice to stand at a lakeside and pee in the ocean or pee in the lake? Isn't it nice? It's only in freshwater bodies, so it's in rivers and lakes and puddles and dams and all this. To stop urinating and stop defecating in the water. Are there other places? Yeah?
I maybe wonder, it's not only a human disease, is it? It goes with other mammals and maybe reptiles.
I'm not sure. I'm actually not sure.
It will not hinder the humans only stop defecating more.
I'm not sure about that. I have to investigate that. So if, for example, if we stop this and still there are lots of sporocytes or snails in the water, humans can still ingest it. So we have to do more, right, than stopping it. What else can we do?
Treat the water.
Yeah, we can filtrate it. So this little guy is not in our drinking water anymore. Yes.
as I understand it, it can also get in other ways than the mouth, so you have to stop swimming in the water, so that's difficult to prevent.
You have to stop swimming in the water? Yeah. Why is that so difficult?
Because there's a lot of fishermen in this water area.
Exactly. It's an occupation, main occupation if you live near a big lake, for example Lake Malawi or any of Lake Botswana in Ghana. It's a huge source of income for people who depend on the fish and other animals. So that's really, really difficult, isn't it? And that's actually one of the main problems in the big control program. How can you tell fishermen not to touch the water? I mean, it's almost impossible, right? But also children. Prevent children from playing in water. It's very difficult, but it's some of the things you have to work with. Yeah, there are actually very creative programs around the world to do this. I met a PhD student from Atlanta who has built swimming pools in Africa for children to swim in. Very low cost, very smart stuff actually, but to prevent the children to go swimming in the lake every day because they were so sick from schistosomiasis. So she created actually other recreational places for children to play in water, clean water. Yeah? Any other ideas? If we think about the snail, any smart technical engineering thoughts in here, and how what can you do about the snail in the water?
You could implement a type of fish eating snails.
You could? Yeah. Yeah. So somebody has to eat the snail and make it disappear. Yeah. There are actually some catastrophic examples in history where smart engineers have built some smart stuff and they have actually increased the natural habitat of snails. Can you imagine why? And they have increased the diseases. For example, if you build a large dam or an irrigation scheme, suddenly there's more water for the snails to be in and more breeding sites. You suddenly have more schistosomiasis. So you have to be really technically smart to get rid of this. There are different ways, and I talked to a guy yesterday in our department, what he would do. He said, well, you can do different things. You can flush the snails or you can strand the snails. So you can actually make some calculations on to provide speed on the water. So the snails cannot breathe, they need to be standing fairly still in the water. So to create some speed so the water is flowing more. Yeah?
And I think it sounds like kind of a dangerous way, because then you're disturbing the ecosystem of the lake.
Yeah.
And you might it might be like a nutrition for the fish, and
sure.
Then suddenly you take away their income.
Sure. So that's, for example, if you're creating irrigation channels, I mean channels that are only transportation ways for water, then you can increase speed, you can maybe not have so many bends and so on. But of course, if it's a natural water or natural water body, you can't increase speed. It's impossible, right? If you have dams or artificial water bodies, you can also level the water. You can vary the levels of water, so at some point you dry out some of the sites, and then you strand the snails so they dry out. So you can do different things, but as long as you make sure you don't increase the amount of snails and actually create schistosomiasis in your irrigation schemes, right? Okay, that was schistosomiasis. You can go much more into detail, but I think you understand now the point of the transmission circle and putting in control measures at different points of the circle. So if you look at where it is in the world, it's almost only in Africa, and it's in places around big lakes, and it's in places with a lot of natural water bodies. And there are very, very big programs now to prevent schistosomiasis. In the last decade, millions and millions of people have been treated. And what is now the most common way is that you do mass drug programs, mass drug administration. So you give medication to people without diagnosis at first. You treat whole villages, especially if you know that they are in high-risk areas. So if they're living on the shore of a lake, And you know there's a load of schistosomiasis in the lake who treat the whole community. Some places you go into school classes and estimate out of a school class how many children are infected, and if it's a high rate, then you treat everybody. It's a complicated program, and there's lots of social and anthropological and economic aspects of having a program like this. For example, fishermen, they think they get sick from taking these pills, maybe you vomit or something, and they're not sure that it's a good thing for them, and then they stay away simply the day that the Ministry of Health is coming to give out drugs to treat them. So there's lots of problems in having these mass drug programs for schistosomiasis. Yeah, that was the first disease, the most complex one, because it involves several stages in humans and outside of humans. So hookworm, which is one of the helminths that we talk about, so soil transmitted infection. Have you read about this? Is it in the chapter? It is? A little bit? Yeah? Okay, so what's the problem with helmets for humans? What's the issue here? Why do we get sick? Do you know that? Have you read about that? All kinds of helmets, not especially hookworm. Yeah?
It thrives in soil. The eggs touch the soil and are hatched. And when they make contact with the skin, they dig into it.
Yeah?
And affect the human.
Yeah, how does it affect the human? Why is it not so good for us to have a hookworm infection?
It depletes on nutrients if it reaches the intestine. I can cause malnutrition.
How?
No.
Okay.
I haven't read that much.
Do any of you know? It's right that it reaches the intestines and it sucks
blood.
Why is that not good? You can imagine a small child living in a poor rural area where the family doesn't have so much food, and then you have hundreds maybe or thousands maybe worms in your intestines, and it sucks blood. It's not so nice, is it? It's really disgusting actually, also when you see these worms that can get up to 10 centimeters long. It causes anemia, blood loss, right? Especially in children and teenage girls. So you lose blood. And because they are in your intestines, you are not so good at absorbing nutrients, like she said, so you can get malnutrition. It actually can get so bad that for small children now there's evidence that it causes not only retarded growth, so you grow slower and you grow in the wrong way, but you can also get cognitively disabled. So children who have heavy loads of these worm infections, they're not making a good progress in school. They're not thinking fast enough. They get low grades simply because they lack nutrients in their bodies. So it's really a disgusting thing, especially for children. So how does it work? You almost explained it, right? But can somebody explain this cycle? It's a quite simple one. Or can somebody give examples of what to do about this worm so we can prevent it? Yeah?
Maybe make sure that we don't touch wherever those larvae are living with, like bad skin.
Yeah, and where are they living?
Well, we have to handle the feces, like not having them on the ground where you step afterwards.
So the eggs are shed in feces from all of us, everybody who's infected, adults and children. So you shouldn't be able to get in contact with the human feces. And how do we prevent that? Yeah.
But also animals. So if you're a cow herder, you shouldn't have sandals or something.
Sandals, shoes. That's control measure number one, right? For everybody. For those in contact with animal and human feces, but also children. There are large programs in Africa that hand out shoes for children so they don't get into trouble. But I mean, if we are a little bit smarter than that, we could eliminate the eggs or the worms from being in the environment in the first place. How do we do that? Yeah.
Toilets.
That's the answer. Latrines, right. That's the main control area for you as engineers. You have to build smart latrines that contain the human pieces in a safe way so nobody can get in contact with that. That's the main thing here, right? There's a quite a simple clinical treatment for this, and I would actually recommend you that if ever you travel out, buy some anti-helmets in the pharmacy before you leave for home, because it's so easily available in any pharmacy in Africa and Asia. You can buy it anywhere, and then you can treat yourself, because in Denmark you have to go to the doctor to get a medication. And it's very, very likely that you're infected if you go traveling in Asia. These helmet eggs are everywhere in the food, in the soil, everywhere. You might touch something, so it's some countries like Vietnam, it's practically impossible not to get infected. Yeah. Okay, latrines is the main thing here. So just for a second, let's go back to schistosomiasis, because I remember something that I didn't say. There's, of course, a major control measure here as well that we didn't mention. Every engineer's favorite. What is that? So we mentioned filtrating the water, sanitation, right, to avoid defecation and urination in the water. Maybe controlling the snails. There's one more. Water supply, right. Water supply. We would like to give people good water so they don't have to drink the infected water from the lake or the river, because for various reasons, that kind of water might not be so good quality. So providing drinking water from another source is also a very big part of schistosomiasis control program. So drilling wells or whatever you might figure out to do. I'm guessing you will get much more technical stuff, is that right, on the water supply later on. But that's, of course, a major thing. So you can filtrate the water, and if you're forced to use the lake water, you can filtrate it, but it would be better, of course, if you get your drinking water from another source. Yeah. Okay, hookworm, if we look at where is it in the world, widespread, you can see that. Widespread across Africa and Asia, part of Asia, it's mainly India, Bengal. I know you have a case, one of the groups. There are very large programs for worm eradication, that is mainly mass drop programs for children. So school-based programs where you give children drugs, and then you take stool tests after some time and see how many have been reinfected, and you treat again. And then on the side, you have your more control and preventive measures. And large, large programs, lots of money is put into these programs for children. Here, the graph shows the country requiring preventive chemotherapy, so that it's an estimate of how many children below 14 needs treatment still. So a way to go. Okay, the next disease will be relevant for your Tanzania cases, I'm guessing, but you have to investigate it more. Trachoma. It's one of the water-washed diseases. Was it in the book? Did you read about it? No. It's an infection. It's a bacterial infection with a chlamydia bacteria in the eyes. And what happens is that you get red eyes, like from any eye infection, and if it gets really bad, you get scarring of the eye. Because of the infection, it will scar the eye, and if it gets really, really bad, the eyelid can turn inwards, and then your eyelashes will irritate the eye so much. And if it gets that severe, you have to be operated, or you need surgery. But before it gets really bad, you can actually do a lot just by washing your face with water frequently. So you wash away the infection, the bacteria from the eyes. That's why it's washed here. Yeah? You can also, there's a major control program, and right now what most organizations is using is a program called SAFE. some places I've also seen it differently spelled, so it's called face, which is easy to remember because it's in the face. And it means surgery, S for surgery, A for antibiotics, F for facial cleaning, and E for environmental control. And the last one, environmental control, it's that you guys, what are we going to do about this disease? Any ideas for prevention? Do you know where it comes from? Yeah?
Well, you said it was water washed, so if you wash your hands,
yeah,
it's like get into the eyes from like touching.
Exactly. So educational programs where you teach people to wash a lot, so teach them to improve their personal hygiene, so facial cleaning. Yeah. But to do that, you need to provide water, right? So water supply might be an issue here. This disease thrives in dry places where there's a lot of flies that can transmit the bacteria from human feces to humans. And in dry areas, you tend to not have so much water for personal hygiene. And if you don't have much water, you have to prioritize, right? So the water is mainly used probably for preparing food. So you have to supply water and tell people to use more water on personal hygiene. Yeah?
The water washed, is it okay just with water, or do you need soap or ash or something else?
Water is fine. Okay. Yeah. It's a mechanical removing of the infection from the eye. Yeah. It doesn't even have to be very high quality. I mean, super clean. Of course, there shouldn't be a lot of dirt in it and stuff like that. But yeah. Any other control measures? Just gave you a couple of hints. How is the disease transmitted to humans? There's a vector. Yeah?
By flies.
By flies. What can we do? Any? Yeah?
Mosquito nets.
Mosquito nets. Fly control. All kinds of fly control. So, locking up your food so flies doesn't get into it. Controlling breeding sites for flies. So, waste management, so you don't have wastes lying around where that attracts a lot of flies. Sanitation, right? So you don't have these flies sitting on the feces and then flying into the eyes of children. So it's a comprehensive program you need to put up here for trachoma. Water supply, sanitation, education is a big part here. Teaching people to get rid of this infection and washing themselves. It's also, you also need to wash your clothes and your mattresses and your things. So it's a little bit of a disinfection. So it's increasing domestic hygiene in general that you need to tell people. It can be a really complicated stuff. And you might also need to bring in surgery teams that can treat infected, those who are really badly infected, so they can get antibiotics and surgery if needed. A lot of people, like you see here, that become blind from untreated trachoma, because it's not it's an infection that you think it's not so bad, I can manage, I'll just wash a little bit, and then it gets gradually worse and worse. And so there's actually a lot of blindness caused by trachoma. So have a look into your, yeah?
Does it only affect the eyes?
Yeah.
Okay, no other.
It's a special strand of the chlamydia bacteria that only affects eyes. Other chlamydia bacteria affects other places only. Yeah? So this is where it is. There's a little bit of a strange thing here. You see Australia is completely blue, which is an endemic area for climbing trachoma. And Brazil. Also India. China and large parts of it. Australia and Brazil, it's mainly the indigenous populations. And in Australia, it's simply because it's very dry and there's a lot of flies. So you in those areas, there are big face or safe programs And Brazil, it's the same. It's in the dry areas and it's the kind of hotspot areas where you have a lot of infection. Yeah? That was trachoma. Guinea worm. This is the nastiest one of them all, I think. Have you heard about this? So the picture is just to explain to you. This is a worm coming out of your foot.
Oh,
yeah. It's really disgusting, isn't it? Yeah. But it's also really painful. And there is no treatment for guinea worm. There's no good chemical treatment. So the treatment is simply to get rid of the worm when it comes out. And what they do, I saw this in Ghana, is that you have a stick and you roll the worm on the stick and attach it to your foot and then you drag the worm out slowly. Yeah, it's really nasty, I know. Should I change the picture?
Yeah.
It's a nematode and it's caused by drinking water that has this nematode or this water flea. It's a small cyclop. And it's really painful to get it. It's almost eradicated. That's the positive story. There's only 3 countries in the world that still have cases, and very few cases. And one of them, the majority of cases is in South Sudan, the newly independent South Sudan. There must be a natural breeding site, I don't know why. But there's a big concern now that because of the Ebola outbreak, that these last spots where you are actually really controlling these places, these infections or the cases and people, that it might be bigger again because there's not a very, because attention is, all attention in the health sectors are being diverted to other places. So you might see a growth in guinea worm again, which is very sad. Yeah. Based on these things, prevention measures should be clear. What are they? Clean drinking water. This cyclops is so big, so you can filtrate it out of the water. It's actually a small flea that you can see with the human eye, so you can filtrate it out of the water. Anything else? That's basically it. Water supply. Think about water supply. Even if you have the smallest number of suspicion in your cases, it should be enough to set up some water supply to avoid anyone. Because it's one of the first parasitic diseases to be it's on the verge of being eradicated in the whole world. So there's so much attention and so much energy put into these eradication programs that if we get rid of the last cases in these 3 countries, it's gone from the world, and that would be nice. So, yeah.
And it won't, like, stay in an animal like Ebola?
I haven't heard. I think not. No. It migrates in the lymph system in humans. It's also why it's so painful. And then it goes into your blood vessels and then it comes out of the skin when it needs to come out. So you see here are the last countries, Sudan, Chad, Nigeria, Mali is on here, but I think it has been declared free now. And Ghana was still here. I think it has also been declared free. And I know India and Pakistan have recently been declared guinea worm free. This is a nasty, nasty guy. Malaria. Fleming Conradson, who usually does this lecture, he says there's always lots of questions about malaria, but actually there's not a really good reason for us to have it to explain a lot about malaria here, because it's actually not so water and sanitation related. Do you know anything about malaria? Yeah. Yeah?
Isn't it from still standing water? Isn't it
like, no, it's
from in still standing water and then the mosquito breeds.
So it's water related because the mosquito breeds in water. And that's the only thing it has to do with water and sanitation, you can say, and hygiene. Yeah. So yeah, so that's why. So it breathes in water, and then it transmits a parasite to the human when it bites you, and this parasite migrates in your body, and it's it feeds on your red blood cells, and they start to rupture, and that's when you get sick from malaria. And the reason why I took it, I want to spend just a few minutes on it. It's a very, very serious killer disease still in low and middle income countries, and then probably in your Tanzania cases there will be malaria that you need to think about. And I asked why is it relevant for environmental engineers? Why is it relevant for you? Or why? Ask another way, why would you as a professional group be the guys to ask to do something about malaria? What can you do? Yeah? In which way?
Well, I don't own mosquito nets, but maybe I'm all
So bed nets, insecticides impregnated bed nets is one of the big things in malaria prevention. But that wouldn't really be the engineering guys, no, right? Yeah.
Maybe eliminate smaller water holes.
Yeah.
So they don't everywhere.
Yeah. So it's all about this environmental engineering. So planning agricultural space and managing water bodies, right? That's what you can do. Vector control, basically, right? So controlling where this mosquito breeds and how many mosquitoes we get produced, you could say. So it's around dams, in irrigation schemes, in water puddles, like you said. There's one species of the mosquito that thrives in these hoof prints from cattle. They like these small pockets of water. And it's typically around the water schemes, big and small, where you have leaking water pipes and standing water. It's all these things you need to design really well, so you don't create these breeding spots for mosquitoes. But it's also this one that relates more to the chemical area of environmental health that we haven't touched at all. But one of the main intervention areas for malaria control is, of course, spraying. Have any of you seen? Since spraying done in any of the cases you tried to, yeah.
Well, they do it when there's a chance of ear epidemic.
Yeah.
They have an update coming up and toxic.
Yeah. Yeah. You can have indoor and outdoor, so you mean outdoor spraying of areas where you could where you have breeding sites. Yeah. There's also big programs where you do indoor spraying. So you spray inside people's houses if you know that there's lots of mosquitoes sitting around in houses, and that's of course really, if you imagine that you are a family sitting in your house and there's suddenly these Ebola guys coming in these space suits with a chemical tank on their back and they start spraying your house with chemicals, it's really, really not a nice thing, is it? And people get very scared, so it's some things that the programs are trying to avoid to do too much, because it's very intimidating for people, right? And lots of people have a high conscious of the damaging effects of chemicals on our bodies, so people also don't like to have all this chemical stuff inside their houses. So malaria control, vector control, you need to think about, especially if you have areas where you have water bodies, right? Trends in malaria. The red ones are the increase in incidence. There's only one spot here. Venezuela, I don't know why. And here you have on track with a 75% decrease. And here you have 50 to 75% decrease. So you see large part of the world is actually doing quite well with eradicating malaria. It's growing really well. And you know this big Bill and Melinda Gates Roll Back Malaria program. They're really posting millions of dollars each year into fighting malaria. So it's going well. There's a lot of fast, but there's insufficient data to assess the trend, whether it's going down or up. But we know from some parts of Africa, Tanzania, actually malaria is going down. And as we've seen it a couple of years now, so we're actually quite sure that malaria is on the decrease in some parts of Africa because of vectors and vector control and treatment and so on. Who are at highest risk for getting malaria?
Children
under 5, always. Yeah. Who else? Pregnant women, always. Anybody else? Yeah? You.
People living
in close to the lakes. Yeah? And not just living, but spending time, right? malaria mosquitoes bite from dusk. From dusk to dawn, yeah, from evening to morning. So in this skumringstid, right? So people who are accessing water bodies and spending time outdoor in these times are at high risk for being bitten. Yeah. Yes.
Also, people living in lower altitudes are more susceptible, I think.
That's right.
I've been in a lot of places in Africa within the tropics, but because it's I think it's about a kilometer in height, where the egg cannot survive.
Right. Yeah, so high altitude areas the mosquito cannot breed. It depends on a quite hot temperature, which is curiously enough why it vanished from Europe a long time ago, because it was too cold. And curiously, it's also the reason why it's coming back now. We have malaria cases in southern Italy now, very sadly. So it's actually a disease that maybe we are controlling it in some places, but it's emerging in other places. It's quite strange, but the world is changing. Climate change, like we talked about in the beginning. Yeah. Other risk groups that we need to think about in malaria? Yeah?
Sick people.
Sick people, yeah. Because they have a poor immune system already. And malaria is actually one of those diseases that you can kind of develop an immunity towards. So some of my Ghanaian colleagues, they still get malaria once a year. But it's just like a flu for a week, and then they're over it. So they've been exposed so many times now, so they're almost in the room where I fall death sick if I get malaria and die. Okay. Was that the last one, or is there one more? I think the last one I put is dengue fever. It's one of the new diseases, and I'm not going to say much, but dengue fever is interesting because it's not one of those classical tropical diseases. It's actually emerging in a lot of urban spaces in middle and higher income areas also now. Cities in the United States are now having small epidemics of dengue fever. It's also a mosquito. It bites all day long, so it's not like protected. You're not protected if you sleep under a bed net. And there's no treatment, which is a sad thing. And there are different types of dengue. You can get dengue and you can just get a very bad flu, but you can also get hemorrhagic or bleeding fever, and then you bleed from different openings and from internal organs, and that you die from. So it is actually a quite serious disease, and it's something that we need to start think about if we work in these urban spots. It has a low mortality, so that's why I think a lot of programs haven't really thought much about dengue fever, because there are not so many people that die from it. But we have a very high mortality or morbidity, so lots of sickness days, months. You can be sick for months. You feel like, I think it's also called breakbone fever, because you feel really poor. You feel like all your bones are hurting you when you have this feverish thing. So the only thing you can do is take some paracetamol and go to bed and hope that you do that is the only thing we can do is to ask environmental engineers to do something about the vector. So vector control is really the only thing we have in the toolbox for doing something about dengue. So it will probably be you in the future that will be, some of you will probably be doing dengue control. So you need to control where this mosquito is and where it lives, and you have to eliminate the breeding spots. And it's a really clever guy, this small dengue mosquito, because it cannot fly so far. So what it does is that it It finds a place to live in a small container or a tire, a rubber tire, or something inside a truck in some plastic sheets, and then it travels in that way. So in that way it spreads quite fast to other areas, to other places, to other urban areas, to collides with other tires, and then it comes out, hatches, and then it comes out and starts spreading the disease again. The reason why it likes to be in urban places, do you know why that is? It's because it likes all these small man-made reservoirs that we have created for these fantastic mosquitoes. So a gutter or a small jar filled with water, a small aquarium or a small puddle in the a drainage that is blocked. Everywhere we can find small dirty potholes of water, that will breed. So you have to, when I go around when I travel in Asia, I always empty up these small cans when I find something with stagnant water. Just empty it and get rid of all these small spots where the mosquito can breed. Yeah? When you start researching for your cases, these are some places where you can breed. WHO homepage is always a good place. You can just tap in the name of the disease and they have a fact sheet for every disease. And then you can read up and check what I told you was correct. And you can draw maps out and you can ask for the country you're working with, Tanzania or India, or is it India? Is it Bangladesh? And you can tap on the map and then you can get disease statistics for every country. And then you can see what kind of diseases you might have in your area. I think Henrik is also going to give you the slides somehow.
Yes.
Yes. So don't worry. Yeah? Take home messages from today. What should they be? What are the essential learnings about these different water and sanitation related diseases? It's up to you. What are the take home messages from these 1.5 minutes? Talk about that for 5 minutes with one next to you. What were the main learnings for you today? And then let me hear it. Okay, what are the take-home messages? Yes? Okay. All right. Anything else? Don't shit where you eat. Why not?
Well, because those parasites come out by shit.
Yeah? Yeah? Yeah, but where should we shit? In the toilets. So don't eat at the toilet. Yeah, yeah.
Or far away from water.
Yeah. So human feces should be kept away from water. Yes. Yes?
Filtrate your drinking water.
Yeah? Filtrate your drinking water. Maybe we could expand it.
Provide clean drinking water.
Yeah? Yeah?
Provide enough water for hygiene as well.
And any kind of hygiene or something specific?
Hand washing.
Yeah. Yeah. And so personal hygiene, I would say. So it's not just hand, it's also face and genitals and stuff like that. But so personal hygiene. Yeah. You could also expand it to domestic, but that would not be for all diseases. For trachoma, it would be good to have a lot of water, to have very high standards of domestic hygiene. So to be able to keep a clean home simply would eradicate. Yeah. Yeah.
No, but it's also important to know which country you're in and which kind of disease you're in.
Yeah. So
why treat for the one that's not in that area?
So know your diseases? Yeah. Anything else? I would like to expand that. So know your diseases and know your risk groups.
So you have to find out who is at risk, where do I need to channel my my energy, and who should I give priority here in this place. Yeah?
Wear
sandals or footwear? Yeah. So not for all diseases, right? But for which one?
Footwear.
Yeah. Let's have something down here from the quiet group down here in the back. What are, what is the main learning from you? Main take home message. Yeah?
Water supply will improve. Water supply improve.
Yeah? Water supply can improve a lot of DC, a lot of health problems, yeah? And and together with sanitation and hygiene, you have done a really, really good job in preventing environmental diseases. Almost 10%, can you remember? 10% of deaths can be prevented with if you prevent water, sanitation, and hygiene diseases. Okay, yeah?
I have a question.
Yeah.
I was visiting this like structure in India where all the taps for drinking water had a little white cotton filter, or like a textile filter around it. And I just thought, that's not gonna do anything. I mean, because everything that's dangerous is like too tiny.
Yeah.
But have you any idea what, like,
well, it could be a kind of a mechanical filter, so you filter out, for example, dirt. But I'm sure if it's mounted directly on the tap, maybe it's not even working for that. I don't know.
It was.
Yeah. So, for example, for these water fleas, right? You can, these cyclops, they are actually so big, so you can filter them out by using a piece of cloth. So you can do something, but you're right, bacteria, viruses, they will go straight through. So there, it's only some diseases you will filtrate out.
Could you infuse it with some kind of poison or something to that? Well, have a, like a little filter with some.
There are many different filters. Maybe you should ask Henrik about this. There are many different filters. There are chemical filters, mechanical filters. There are organic, non-organic. Lots of different filters for different purposes. Maybe you should.
Yeah. No, but it sounds strange if you say it's a cloth. I think you could even get more.
Some years back, where they discovered that, in particular, cholera bacteria are so large that an old sari with, you know, threadbare material can actually filter it.
Yeah.
Away most of it.
Yeah. The problem is that cholera bacteria are highly infected, so even if you get most of it, it's not enough.
Yeah.
You would still have cholera cases, especially if it's cholera from children, because they shed more infective bacteria than others. So it's not optimal. No. Yeah. These are the take-home messages for you. You can, of course, add more if you like. When you come home, Henrik said that it would be an extremely good idea to show you this. Have you seen it before? It's the F diagram. It's the Holy Grail. Like me, it's very old. Like you said, it's the first edition. It's slightly different from this. Was drawn in 58. I don't know Wagner and Van Wagner. Do you know that, Henrik? Do you know the original authors? But anyway, this diagram is a nice and simple way of thinking about these transmission routes that we've been talking about with the diseases. These are for the fecal-oral transmission routes, right? So fecal feces in one, and then ingested by a new host, a human, through the oral pathway. And there are pathways in between here that we can think about when we want to interrupt this transmission route of bacteria, for example, cholera or other diarrheal disease. And it's good to think with these Fs, in the F diagram, because that's the different pathways that the bacteria takes. And I think we've talked about most of them today, haven't we? So can you give me an example where bacteria moves from feces through fluids to foods and to a new host? Does it make sense? Yeah? Yeah? Why fields? So through fluids, fluids through the water, right? Yeah, with an intermediate vector, the snail. And then, but food's not really food, right? But directly ingested by the humans. They drink the water. Yeah. Okay. Fields? Any ideas here? How can humans ingest something from fields? You can say it goes directly from fields to host, but it also goes through food. Any ideas?
Hookworms.
The hookworms, yeah. Why fields? So soil, it could also be soil, right? The soil transmitted helminths. They move through from the feces, they are exposed on the soil, and here it would go directly if you step on it, right, and you get infected. How could the ripworm, we didn't put it, but it could go through food, how? It's not so strange. Yeah?
Is it if you don't wash it?
Yeah, for example. So for example, in Vietnam, there's a lot of vegetable production. So you have all these women standing in the fields all day, fertilizing all these onions or whatever it is with a fertilizer made of human excreta. So you have lots of bacteria, lots of diseases potentially in the fields. And then when they pick the salad or the onions, it's on the food. So if you don't wash it carefully, you eat it, you get sick. So food safety here is the issue, right? You can do different things to interrupt this. What could you do? Yeah?
Don't eat raw food.
Don't eat raw food. That's a major, also as a traveler. Never, ever eat raw food, right? Cook it, something that is cooked or something you have to peel. That's the main rule, right? Because otherwise it's not safe. So you have to treat the food, basically. That's what you can do. What can you do here to prevent it moving from fields into the food? Any of you are from farming families or know something about agriculture or farming? Or have you seen fields where they do fertilize? Not really. Yeah?
We try to put the fertilizer directly into the ground.
Exactly. So you don't spray it on top of the leafy vegetables. Yeah, there are actually systems for this. You can have small pipes lying on the soil where you drip irrigate, for example. You know that? So instead of pouring water on top of it, you lay some pipes out with small holes in there so the water drips on the ground. Yeah. Preventing the fecal material to go onto the fields, that's of course a little bit difficult if you are doing agriculture where you need human feces as fertilizers. But what can you then do to prevent that all these infectious agents that are in the feces, they, yeah?
There's something about that you can dry the feces so you kill the feces.
Yeah, you compost, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. you compost the fecal matter to a point where it's safe. And if you think about the helminths, they can actually survive for months, even up to years, in places where the growth conditions are optimal. So you can do different things. You can dry it, like you said. You can expose them to sunlight, or you can increase the temperature. There's some very odd experiments that some of my colleagues in Ghana are doing there, and in Vietnam, they're trying to have these compost heaps where they do different things to the material, and then they measure how many eggs are still there or how many bacteria. So they increase the temperature, or they put lime on to decrease the pH, or they use more or less liquids, and they do different things. So you need some guidelines for how to treat fecal matter before it's safe to use. In Vietnam, the guidelines now is that you have to compost it at least for 6 months without touching it before it's safe. But you can decrease that time if you, for example, increase temperature. Yeah? So, of course, you could also substitute your fertilizer with something chemical, but that costs money, right? So in the places where you have agriculture dependent on human feces as fertilizer, it's really a smart thing for them because they use their own shit, so to say, and to make an income, right? Okay, I just need flies and fingers. Fingers? So think of a Danish kindergarten. And the small kids, they had to go to toilet. And they go out there and it's strange. I always wonder why that is. But in the toilets, maybe you have a child in the kindergarten, right? In the toilet, isn't it? They have three or four toilets in the same room. Yeah, so you have three or four kids sitting there and shitting and having a good time together and playing. And so maybe they don't remember to wash their hands after. And then they go out and play with the toys. And suddenly you have fecal matter all over the place. And you have a lot of diarrhea and respiratory infections. They also move the fingers. Yeah. So hand washing, I'll come back to it next week when I get back, is a major, 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 major thing.
How long can the feces stay on a
I don't actually know, but it's within hours, I think. It's not several days. But if you imagine this kindergarten, it's constantly renewed, the inspector. So what they actually do in some kindergartens now is that they put all the toys in the washing machine to disinfect it sometimes. Flies. You heard about a couple of diseases today that move through flies. Trachoma, one of the big ones. So you can prevent flies accessing the feces, which is by what? There should be a loud choir now saying sanitation, right? Sanitation, right? So if you keep the fecal matter in a closed chamber, in a toilet, you don't have flies. And there are lots of techniques to prevent flies from either coming into the toilet or flying out of the toilet. So sanitation really is the one thing that can break the transmission loop here. And flies, prevent flies from accessing the food. You have to lock up your food or have screens on the doors or something like that. So the F diagram, use it to remember these pathways that you can break to prevent this, these fecal-oral transmission.